Four questions which I'd like to address in 20 minutes. When will renewables transform assets? Will renewables keep us to the carbon budget? What is the value of climate change? And is climate change a specific risk for the finance sector? Well, my starting point on this is to start with BT, who publish every year their 20-year view of growth in their various product market sectors. On the left here are their growth rates for fossil fuel use and generation. Gas at 2%, coal at 1%, nuclear and hydro 1.5%. And up here, a great deal of vision, they see renewables growing at 6%. Moving on to transport, which I'm also going to talk about, they see oil in transport growing at around just under 1%, vehicle fleet growing at 3.5% ad infinitum, lots of measures to reduce emissions, talk about that, leaving about 8% of growth. And for electric vehicles, they see, well, they don't see very much on the 20-year view. Now, so that's BP, and it's good for BP. Buying gas is good for Shell, of course. What does the renewables industry say? Well, looking at the past, wind has grown at 20% a year over the last decade, solar at 50% a year or something like that over the last decade. If you look at UBS's reports, they see electric vehicles growing compound at about 35-38% a year from a low base. And these numbers are very large compared to 6%. So something doesn't add up, and let's just explore what it is for a minute. Well, the wind industry, looking forward, sees growth rates of something like 0-4% a year, depending on what assumptions it makes. But it doesn't think that will be steady exponential growth. When it thinks, the way it works out what's going on is this. It takes whatever growth rate it thinks, let's say 3%. It says, what would happen to wind capacity if it grew 3% per annum to 2050? It works out a number. And then it says, well, you won't actually grow 3% per annum. What we'll do is follow an S-shaped curve, the shape market penetration curve. So we'll grow quickly to start with, and then the growth will slow. Oh, good. So, you can just call the vibrations a minute. So the industry says exactly the same thing. Let's see what we think the growth rate is, projected to 2050 exponentially, but then assume, in fact, we follow a market penetration curve. The solar industry says that the underlying growth rate is like 10% per annum. Electric vehicles, well, we don't know where we're going with electric vehicles at the moment, because that all depends on battery prices. Batteries are coming down in price about 15% per annum. If they continue to do that, then electric vehicles will be competitive on capital cost with oil vehicles around 2023. They'll be cheaper in lifetime ownership costs by the time they become competitive in capital costs. So you could expect quite a large takeoff in electric vehicles sometime in the early 2020s. Autonomous vehicles are coming in. We should get autonomous vehicle fleets appearing sometime in the 2020s. By the time they appear, electric vehicles should be the cheaper option. So you should get quite a large push in electric vehicle use. And the sort of thing that the electric vehicle industry is thinking about is again, an S-shaped market penetration curve that could see electric vehicles, shall we say, taking 15% of new vehicle sales by about 2030. It's that sort of thing, maybe it's 10, maybe it's 15. Now, the growth rates I've just been talking about right across the piece depend on costs continuing to fall as they have, so that wind and solar become increasingly competitive. They depend on grid technology maturing so that one can handle intermittency on quite large scale in grids. So it's a technologically optimistic view. What is the consequence of this? Well, it's this.
So over here, this is electricity generation. The brown line is gas and coal use in electricity generation as projected by BP. And then what I've done to BP's projections is eaten away at them with solar and wind. Here's the green line here is wind building up towards 2050. The yellow line is solar building up, which it would be S-shaped if it wasn't for the fact that I've added on the demand from electric vehicle growth to generation. And the consequence of reducing BP's forecasts for gas and coal by what renewables will do is you get a peak in something like 2020, 2025 in gas and coal. Now that's kind of interesting. What would a peak mean then? Well, it would mean that we're going down the super cycle in coal and gas demand at the moment. It will go to the bottom, it will begin to come up again, prices will firm, they'll firm into the 2020s, and then boom, they'll meet something like this. The prices will drop. Gas and coal will become, if gas and coal for electricity generation will become uneconomic somewhere around here, according to these very simple projections. Over on the oil in transport, here's oil use building up BP as the petrol vehicle fleet grows. Here's my forecast eroding the demand for oil. So what I see, based on these very simple forecasts, is oil for transport peaking around 2030, 2035. This is 10 million barrels a day. If oil out here has the same sort of marginal cost as it does at the moment, around here the oil price will drop dramatically as you take 10 million barrels a day off demand. So, simple forecasts suggest oil assets stranding in the mid-2030s. Coal and gas stranding in the mid-2020s, oil stranding in the mid-2030s. Now, there are a lot of experts in the room who can do much, much more thoughtful stuff than this. And the point of this is not to offer a competing forecast. It is to show you how simple it is to work out numbers which show stranding of assets, not for regulatory reasons, but for technological reasons, because of the way we subsidize wind and solar and electric vehicles to get them going. The point, that's one point, the simplicity. The second point is this, as I said, I'm just an investment banker, doing capital issues for companies, doing prospectuses and so on. We used to worry a great deal about what we put in the risk statement, what were the risks to the business in the future. But when Glencore is doing its rescue capital issue, Mr. Glazer stood there and said, coal has got a definite future. He is wrong. It's not as straightforward as that. He may be right that you can create a case where coal will have a definite future, but this sort of thing says the risk is high. And it's time for bankers and lawyers and accountants to start putting in risk statements in prospectuses which take this sort of thing into account. Now, moving on. That's all very interesting. Does it mean we've solved the problem? Well, here are BP's projections, the brown line for aggregate fossil fuel use. This is taking electricity generation, transport, and added industrial use. Up they go. The green lines are my adjustments. Once you add back in industrial use, of course, you get only a very, very small rate of decline in fossil fuel use. The slope of the decline there is about 0.5% here, quite enough to take us to 4 degrees by the end of the century. So, without new regulations, that's where we head, which means we have to think about what this does to the economy and what it does to the value of investments. So that takes me on to the subject of climate damage functions. There's been research going on into climate damage functions for about 2 decades at least. The climate damage function expresses the percent by which global gross domestic product is reduced at each level of warming compared to what it would have been if there had been no warming. So when anybody in the city, lots of economists look at these things. They look at this function down here, this little grey one, which is due to Nordhaus about 20 years ago. It says that the damage caused to the global economy is at 4 degrees, about 5 or 6%. If the global economy is growing at 2 or 3% a year, it doesn't matter. Okay? Climate damage doesn't matter. Bad for the people who suffer it, about 6% damage against an economy growing at 3% a year is 2 years off growth in a century. It doesn't matter. There's no point us sitting here. It's a waste of our time if we believe that. Just kind of interesting. Other economists, however, two economists, two views, other economists think that climate damage will grow much more quickly than that. And the way they work out about it is they say if the world were to heat to 11 or 12 degrees, it would wipe out the economy. Temperatures in continental interiors will be about 20 degrees higher. That would do for us. So you start here, you've got to end up here, so there must be a line that does something like that. And what's going on when it rises quickly is you're getting social breakdown. You've got a very tightly integrated world economy. You're hitting it with all sorts of things. One of the things could, for example, be halving of food of yields from growing wheat and so on. And that would lead to global food crises and all the rest. Whatever story you want to make up, you can make up. But you travel up the curve like this. Well, the question is, a curve like what? So this one begins to turn up at around 4 degrees. This one begins to turn up after 3 degrees. This is due to Simon Dietz and Nick Stern at the London School of Business. At the London School of Economics. This is due to Marty Weitzman. We don't know. We don't know what sort of curve we're going to go up. But you can see that this opens up the risk quite a lot. You can use those curves to calculate value at risk. This is my definition. Investment value was if asset prices were to take into account a plausible worst case of time damage. And plausible means having a probability that investors judge cannot be ignored. So what I've done is this. I have projected dividends on the century, assuming they grow at 2 or 3%. I've applied those damage functions to reduce them. I've also made the assumption, along with Dietz and Stern, that if damage climbs up to 50%, then growth, underlying growth, will come down. And I've just calculated the difference in the present value of dividends with and without warming. So if you do the calculation now, as at 2015, discounted cash flow back to 2015, the Nordhaus assuming either 4 or 5 degrees, you get a reduction in portfolio value of about 3 or 4%. Doesn't matter at all. For Weizmann, 2015, 4 or 5 degrees, for that damage curve, you get a reduction in value, again, 3 or 4%. Doesn't matter. For Dietz and Stern, kind of interesting, 7%, 6 or 7% if you assume 4 degrees of warming by the end of the century, 13 or so percent if you assume 5 degrees of warming. Those numbers are material. So if we believe that the Dietz-Stern damage curve is plausible, then as portfolio managers, we have to think about that. We have to work out how we're going to manage that risk. This is, of course, a systemic risk. How long do I have?
You have about 3 minutes.
Okay. Comparing this with this going out 20 years, you can see the risk goes up very quickly. It's going up about 50 basis points a year. The last thing I want to tell you is how you might quantify those curves. We don't know what the curves can be. We can build a whole family of curves indexed by when they reach 50% damage. We can then say to ourselves, what probability distribution do we think? What probability do we attach to damage being 50% of 6 degrees or 3 degrees or 4 degrees? I put a normal distribution on that. And that gives you some sense of how likely the Dietz and Stern equals 4 degrees to 50% damage is. And as you can see, T equals 9 degrees for this curve is more or less the Nordhaus damages. T equals 4 degrees is more likely than T equals 9 degrees. We are more likely to be going up a high damage curve than a low damage curve. So, lastly, value at risk. Here's a calculation. Bar is the value impaired in a plausible worst case. What is a plausible worst case? Expect 3 to 4 degrees by 2100. That's half where we're on at the moment. Add about 1 degree 4 factors a long tail to those projections. Expect damage to be Weizmann, but go to Deeps and Stern for a plausible worst case. So my definition of plausible worst case is 4.5 degrees of warming by the end of the century. Deeps and Stern damages give you a value of risk of 10%, rising 50 basis points per annum. This is what dividends do in a plausible worst case. That's without warming. This is with warming. And all of our financial system is postulated on growth. Dividends stop growing around about mid-century and then go in decline. That's the financial system under very severe stress. What should we do about it? Just 30 seconds over. We own collectively 30% of emissions as investors. We have to control the risk. Climate risk is systemic and can't be hedged. There are value-creating projects that reduce emissions. We should be forcing companies to adopt projects that reduce emissions by voting for them. Thank you.